No, we don't cut.
Oh, you don't?
No.
Oh, that's
no
good
cutting.
To know.
But if you're hacking,
and
it's okay.
If I cuss?
You can cuss.
Okay.
You can do it all. You can say pussy.
I won't say pussy.
You can say pussy. All you like.
It's just, you know what? It's surprising because we in America, women in America don't use that word.
Yeah, no.
Yeah.
You wouldn't use that word
no.
like that.
Anyway, I think they were talking about movie parodies in porn. Was there... their interest, which are very popular these days. I'm sure there's a Rizzoli and Isles episode out there somewhere.
I don't want to see it if there
Rizzoli
is.
Rizzoli and Isles,
really. You know what? There's already enough like graphics and things that they do that you're just very disturbing.
Do you
the fantasies, do you know, of just... Yeah.
Do you avoid Googling yourself for this reason?
Yes,
or do you,
yes.
You got over Googling yourself a while ago? Or?
Well, internet is another conversation we can talk about.
Is it a little uncomfortable?
You know, I just feel like... I said this to someone the other day, and she's one of those real fans. Like, she really is fans of shows, and she really follows people and knows what's going on and so forth. And I said to her, but don't you feel bad about your life and yourself sometimes? Like, you're it's not just the show. You're following people and a persona, but you don't know who they are. You think that their lives are far more glamorous and happier and, you know, all these things more than yours. It's not who we are. So I feel like in some strange way, it just makes me uncomfortable sometimes that it's this kind of narcissistic project for us, but for them, they like love it. They want the project. I feel I'm not sure. I think you have to be very careful with it. The information exchange is information that stays, I don't know, look, people want that image, I don't, so I always think of the person on the other end, and I would never want to present something that isn't. I mean, this is our life. I get it when you're promoting something mm-hmm. and you have a specific thing you're promoting, but now it's infiltrating the real life.
And the illusion within that.
And the illusion within that. That's what it is. It's not the other stuff. There's no boundary anymore.
Mm. So did you discover this in a process of becoming a TV star? Was that the lesson of the first
yeah,
couple years?
Yeah, because when we had to start getting Twitter accounts, which I did with Rizzoli and Isles, I don't really stop and go, oh, here, let me selfie myself. You know, I don't really think that way. It doesn't happen for me like that. So mm-hmm. I didn't quite know how to do it. And then I sat down with somebody who did that, and I said, well, how do I make this work for me?
So
what
do you
am
selfie
I comfortable
yourself now?
With it? Sometimes, when I think it's funny, like yesterday I did because my hairdresser, I'm not kidding, I was looking down, reading my lines, and I look up and my hair is teased. I mean, total Texas, like huge. I thought, what are you doing? It was the funniest, so I did selfie that yesterday because I thought it was hilarious.
I think Laura Benanti has actually like a completely separate career based on her Twitter feed alone.
Really?
It's like she's a Broadway actress, you yeah. know, primarily, but she's like so big on Twitter now.
Some people are so good at it.
Yeah.
They're funny and irreverent.
She really cares about it. She really like makes
really?
It, you know, she's invested apparently.
Well, you
and
know,
she's funny.
The positive side of it is that I have met some followers and fans and through the process that live all over the world that have come out to visit. Mm-hmm. They've met, they've become friends and people who share interests, and it's been that part of it I think is really positive and great.
So are there Rizzoli and Isles cons?
Yes.
Do you have events like
yeah.
you go to? And
there's been one. Huh. Rizzles Con.
Rizzles Con is mm-hmm. what they call it? Wow. That's wild.
Yeah, it is wild.
And have you done Comic-Con?
No. Before? You know, Warner Brothers doesn't... They only take like their sci-fi shows.
Yeah.
So it's weird because a lot of people did expect our show to go. It was based on books and no, we never went.
Well, I guess I think of your show as more for adults. Or am I being wrong about that?
We have a pretty young female.
The kids are out there?
Yeah. Well, but it's a crime show. It's an adult show.
Yeah. So what did you want to do when you grew up? When you were a kid, were you wanting to do this? Was this your, have you moved into your goal in life as a child or?
You know, I have. You know, I did not come from a family. I came from a family of immigrants, and this was not the business they were in. They were very practical, and you know, it was really about surviving, making a living, and that's what you do. You make smart decisions that will give you longevity and security. But at the age of five, I did write in my little kindergarten journal, what do you want to be when you grow up? And I wrote an actress or a teacher. Hmm.
So was there ever a decision to make, or were you always, did you go to become an actress?
There definitely was a decision to make. I ice skated, then I did theater, and a lot of performance stuff, I danced professionally. But I really felt like after college, like, what would it be? The idea of becoming an actor and stepping out into the world and really pursuing that as your profession was frightening to me.
Understandably.
I really was. I felt, first of all, a lot of faces that I would see on TV were not faces that looked like me. You know, I felt like they were, you know, everyone had a little button nose and blonde, and I wasn't, you know, all American in that way. Mm-hmm. And so I just, even though I was born and raised here, I still had family that was European, so I was kind of this mix. And for some reason, I didn't know that there would be a place for me. Mm-hmm. And that's just how I felt. So I went to film school at USC, and I decided that I would pursue, you know, behind the scenes. I loved to make movies, and I loved TV, and I thought, well, I want to learn all the other stuff, so maybe that would be my road. And I fell into the directing and producing arena. That's what I came out wanting to do, more producing. And I went to work for a producer, and while I was there, they were doing a movie, and the casting director came in. She looked at me, and she said, you're an actress. You should read for this particular role. And I said, no, I'm not. I mean, I did. I acted, but no, I'm not acting now. And I hadn't acted in 5 years. And then that kind of put a bug in my ear again, and I decided that I would try again. I think what I learned as well on that job was that everything in this business is really hard, so you have to choose the thing that you love the most.
So did you like producing?
I do. I love producing.
So that's...
And I still have little projects on the side. I used some of the first money I ever got to option material. So it's always been a thing. I came out of film school with some very talented friends, and we had projects that we always wanted to get off the ground, and I was part of their development process and doing that. So I love it. I think it's, I love the creative part of bringing something to life that wasn't there. So I love that.
So was acting what you expected it to be once you became a professional actress in Hollywood?
Yes and no. It's funny, right now I feel I'm in a place where it's reconnecting to the reason I loved it to begin with. Mm. I did a lot of theater, as I told you. I went to the Royal Shakespeare Company and studied. I did a lot of summer stock in New York. I did I had these experiences that were really about the rehearsal, the craft, the finding of the character. What was this process? And then when you start auditioning and you're going out 5 times a day and you've got, you know, costumes in your car and you're just kind of running around like mad, you lose that because you don't have time to prepare. Mm. So I had to gain the tools of understanding how do you work under pressure and then how do you enjoy it? Like, how do you make television, make 24 episodes a year, 17 hours a day, getting scripts at 3 a.m. when you're on camera at 6 or 7 a.m. and you hadn't have any time to look at it, mm-hmm. how do you enjoy that? And I have to be honest in saying there's a lot of it I didn't enjoy. Mm. A lot of it. And that's when I thought, I don't want to do I can't do TV anymore. I need to just do plays or a movie or things that just have a limited time to it. And even when I said yes to Rizzoli and Isles, it was 10 episodes. Mm-hmm. So that's only 3 months a year, and I felt like I could manage that, but now we're shooting 18. So I think though that now I've reconnected to that love in a different way, and I work hard at enjoying every moment and trying to make something of every moment. I put time into it. You know, if there's scenes that I'm not phoning it in. And I think that that's really easy to do on television sometimes.
So you really have to consciously stop yourself from just falling into the normal pace, just to getting it out there?
It's a normal thing that happens. Mm-hmm. There's so many actors I spoke, fabulous film actors that do TV and then sort of go, I don't know what to do with this process. I don't have time to do any of the things I need to do. It's driving me crazy. I remember working with Hugh Laurie on House, and you know, people had said, oh, you know, he's very particular about this, that, and the other, and I adored him and I adored how he worked, but he needed his time. Mm-hmm. Like, he needed to know what was happening, and I loved it. I was so enamored by the fact that he took that moment in rehearsal to really ask the questions, to really, you know, make it better.
Well, there's always that conversation about series, that particularly in hour-longs, you're changing directors all the time.
Yeah.
And, you know, so in many ways, the actor is the director in terms of the performance.
Correct.
And you're kind of stuck with that. But I guess in some ways that can be a good thing if you find the way to make it work for you.
It can be a good thing, but it's exhausting as well. Mm-hmm. Like, recently I worked with a new director, and he just hadn't directed our show. Lovely man, but I had this monologue, and very funny, and I had all of this technical stuff I had to do with it. Mm-hmm. And it was hard. It was like a hard piece of material that I wanted to nail. Mm-hmm. And I told him what my goals were. Like, you know, I want it to be funny, but I feel, you know, I'm in my head about this part. And so, anyway, I did this take, and it was silence behind the monitor. Nothing. It came out. We'll do another one. I said, okay, we do another one. Silence. So I said, hey, what's going on? Doesn't say anything. I said, was it funny? Did you cry? Did you feel anything? Did you see it? He said, oh, I'm so sorry. Sometimes I get in my, he was an editor, I get in my editing cave. Hey. And I said, well, that's great, but right now you're directing, so can you get in your directing cave and help me out? I just want a little bit of feedback here. And so that was like a moment where you're having to, yeah, you know, be in the moment of it. I don't want to be judging myself while I'm performing. But on the other hand, you do want somebody on the other end who you trust that's helping calibrate the performance and keep things looking good.
So does that end up being the guy on camera too, or?
Was what?
Does that end up being the guy on the second camera, or the, you know, one of the gaffers who, you know, whether your performance is working?
You know what? I do have a couple guys on set who are, you know, filmmakers that do help me out here and there, whose opinions I really trust. They know what I like and what I don't, and sometimes be like, go take a look. And what do you think happened over there? And they'll let me know.
It's always dangerous to crack up the crew, I guess. It's the old shtick about that. So then you decided to go this year to spend a little time with the Shameless group.
A little time, yes.
Which is exactly like the character in Rizzoli and Isles. They're sisters. They're twins.
Right.
So was that a decision to do something very different?
Absolutely.
And did they come to you to pursue them?
Well, I'll tell you, I had a limited time to work, so I said to my agents and my manager, you know, I want to make it count. If not, I want to be home with my family because I worked all year. So it better be something different, and I don't care what it entails. You want me to shave my head? Great. You want me to play? You know, I don't care. Let's do it. But bring me something good. So there was a film that came along that I absolutely loved. And the dates were, they kept pushing it. And that film was a very interesting and very different role for me. Mm-hmm. And then I got this call from one of the producers of Shameless, who I had worked with, the John Wells team, some years ago and did a series called Presidio Med. They gave me my first kind of significant job in television. Because there was a role that they gave me which was written much older, and they made her younger, and so they kind of adjusted this role to me. And I worked with Dana Delaney and Blythe Danner and Anna Deavere Smith, Julianne Nicholson, like a really great group of women.
By the way, Blythe Danner's around here somewhere right now.
Oh, she is?
Yes, she has a movie that's junketing in the building.
Oh, really? Yeah. Oh, I have to go see her. She's one of my favorite people in the world. So I had this incredible experience with them. And the show didn't go long, but we stayed in touch, and they were just, you know, my favorite people ever. So I got this call, and they said, we have this role, and we thought of you, but it's pretty risque, and do you want to talk about it? Would you consider it? So we got on the phone, talked to Nancy Pimental and Christopher Chulak and Andrew Stern, and we talked about what the role was and what it entailed, and I just wanted to know more who the person was, more than the nudity. You know,
so when they say to you, we had this risque role, we thought of you.
Yeah.
Is that a compliment?
I was so excited. It truly, every part of me lit up. And I'll tell you why. It's an adult role. And she's strong and intelligent and sexy in this, you know, I mean, her value, I would say her values are riding the line. But it was so different for me. It was something I could really sink my teeth into. It was going to show different colors. And that challenge was super exciting for me. And I knew that, you know, the Wells team, they're such a classy group of people. I was a huge fan of the show as well. Mm-hmm. I was a fan of Lip, who played Jeremy Allen White, who I was going to get to work with, and Bill Macy and Emmy. So all of it just felt really appealing to me. And as it turned out, the film dates couldn't work. This worked out, and there I was on their set, which was very different than mine. I finished the fifth season of Rizzoli and Isles on a Friday, and I was on the set of Shameless on Monday. So I had very little time to change gears into this very different role.
And is this strange feeling going from a set that's yours, basically, to a set that you're the outsider on?
A little bit. But everyone was really welcoming. They're a really good group of people. And the show is very unique in the way that it's so courageous that they're constantly pushing boundaries and tackling topics that are controversial and everything else. But you never know what you're going to get in the script. Like, you think, they'll never do that. And then you read it, and they do exactly that. So I even said to Bill Macy at one point, I said, so you never know like where what the arc of the character will be? He said, a little bit, but you don't know how specifically they'll do it, and more often than not, you read it, and you go, no, they're never going to make them do that, and then they do. So that is exciting.
Right. So you didn't get the entire arc when you started. You
a little bit, not the whole thing. Huh. And it's still open-ended, so we don't know. We don't know what's going to happen.
It could be like a whole other thing.
Who knows? I liked it. I thought that it was an interesting. Some things changed in the final episode. They didn't... There was no time to do some of the scenes that we had that kind of wrapped it up, so they chose not to, but they ended with, you know, his character saying he was falling in love with Helene, so I don't know what that means.
So as an acting challenge, was it interesting? Yeah. Was it hard? Was it...
All things. It was frightening. It was pretty frightening. I mean, I've never been completely naked on camera like that. I've done love scenes, but you have, you know, a sheet and so forth. But on Shameless, it all goes. Like, there is no shame. It's like, you know, really, truly. And the crew is so used to it that it's kind of like working on a porn set. Because you just kind of go, all right, yeah, it's fine. Like, I've seen the guy with his sock on 100 times. Nobody cares. But when you're new to that, naturally, you're a little... You know, trying to be somewhat prissy about it, but that didn't work because that wasn't the character. And so I had to step into the shoes of this woman who was very much in control. Mm. And that meant owning my sexuality and being in control of the situation with my fellow actor. And that's what it was. The first scene we ever did was the scene where in her office, the really naughty scene. And it was like 7 o'clock in the morning in San Pedro, super sexy.
Yeah, it's hot.
And I remember just, you know, coming in and just being in the character of it. And then we had to rehearse the technical part of when they actually begin to make out and then how that physically happens. And I didn't really understand how that would happen. How do you shoot that? And, you know, they have tricks for everything. And they've got underwear for everything and bras for everything. And they've got metal things. They've got cotton things. I mean, you could not imagine. I say metal because literally there is like apparatus that if you were not comfortable with a person even getting near you, you could wear that as some kind of a, you know, it's really interesting. So it looks on film one way, but the person doesn't even touch you sometimes. So very funny.
But it's like a skill set unto itself. They could like open a whole business.
It is. Emmy Rossum gave me a few tips on some things on how to do it, which was really funny because one day we had male directors, but one day we got a female director who was actually the toughest. Like, she was like, I want to see more. I need to see nipples. I need to see this. I said, great, then show your nipples. What are we talking about here? In the script, it said postcoital. So that's what I thought that was happening. And then when we got in the rehearsal, she wanted to start it pre-postcoital, and so it meant a whole other thing. And I panicked a little bit, and I looked at Jeremy and I said, is this like a Shameless thing? Like, it's written one way and then it's something else? Is that what you do? It just goes out the window? He said, no, you know. So I went to speak to her to really understand what it was going to be, because I didn't have to do it.
Right.
But if it makes sense to the scene and it adds to the scene, then I understand. And so we came to an agreement that made us both comfortable, but it was a pretty funny conversation. Like, you do have pretty weird conversations about these things.
So did you ever get used to it? Did you ever become like, no big deal?
Yes, one of our last scenes that we did, it took hours upon hours, and I was in bed with the actor, the DP on one side, the camera guy on the other side. I'm not kidding, all in bed together for a good 4 hours. And I got a little just kooky, and I was just, it was hot in the room, and you're in a negligee. I mean, it was just weird. Like, you just sort of look around and go, what was it like to make Last Tango in Paris? Like, what? It's just, you don't get those experiences so much. But the acting challenge was also, it's all part of it. It was all part of it, and getting to, like, underneath the person and the motivation and... also understanding, for me it was important as a guest star to understand my role in their story.
Mm-hmm. You know? You're not like going out to the Beverly Hills Hotel and stripping down and jumping in the pool these days. You haven't gone to another place with your...
Not yet.
It's
at
not
home.
The thing now.
At home, but...
So did you watch your performance? Do you...
Yes.
Do you watch all your... Are you comfortable
once.
Watching yourself work?
Okay. Once. I watch things once. I like to see how it comes together, but then I don't want to sit there rewinding. Unless it's good, then maybe I would rewind it and think, you know.
Were you surprised by how it came together?
I was surprised how sexy it was. I knew that it would be. There was a naughtiness to it, and that was part of it. But, you know, we had good chemistry, and there was more, which made me very happy. I felt there was more going on between the two characters. It wasn't just sex. There was some kind of connection she saw in him, and he grew to see in her, and that was making it awkward, and I think in a very funny way. But then, it was fun to watch him in this situation. We've seen that character always in control with the women that he's with, and this was the first time that he's not in control, and I think that's what the fans liked as well, and that made me happy. I was scared about. The transition and doing it, and what that would mean for my fans. Like, would they make the jump with me? Mm-hmm. As the air date was approaching, I thought, will they watch it, and will they like it, and what will happen? And they really, really did. And I felt like, well, then I did my job well, because I played along in this world with these, you know, with these people, and they believed that world, and that's all that matters. They weren't watching me, they were watching Helene.
Is having people as conscious of you on and off camera in the world a good feeling, a weird feeling? Is it hard?
I think there was a moment that it was hard, and now I don't feel that anymore. I feel maybe it's, you know, experience and age that you start to understand that it is part of your job. Mm-hmm. And as we talked about, I think the social media stuff can be a pressure that you have to gauge and sort of step back sometimes and take control of your life and your choices. But I do, I'm more used to it now. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So where does it
go? And I like it. I mean, actors love to be approached and told, I love this and I love that. And what do you think? I mean, that's why we do it. So
most
I'm
actors.
Always.
I know a couple actors who are really freaked out by it still.
Well, listen, if I'm having dinner with my family and my kids, it's definitely awkward when the person, you know, comes up and goes, wow, I saw you naked last night on that thing. You're like, you know, come on, I got my kids here. So I think that can be really weird. But if it's in the right moment and they're polite about it, I think it's really sweet.
I'm guessing the kids don't have a Showtime subscription.
Absolutely not. Not even a Rizzoli and Isles subscription.
Like, so they're used to probably seeing mommy around the house.
That's
you know,
it. That's what they see.
Really not that big a deal.
On interviews. They can see mommy in interviews.
That's true.
Yeah.
But not naked in interviews.
No.
You know, there used to be a naked talk show on Channel J in New York many years ago called Interludes After Midnight. And it was people would just sit there and have this conversation. And the guy who was the host was horrible looking. And you'd watch it, and you're like, why does this man have his clothes on off of my television set, talking to whatever porn star or stripper or whatever it was? But it was like, it was a weekly show.
Weird.
Yeah, cable, the evolution of cable has taken away the local access weirdness, I think. I don't know if it was ever in L.A., but when I was, you know, young, I was a kid, I was, you know, watching that stuff, I was like, ooh.
Sounds like a Playboy show.
Well, you know, anyway, there's a whole conversation about that. Because, you know, there's some very big names in town who worked for Playboy early on in the day.
Yeah.
And, you know, have you evolved into something else? But, yeah, Playboy's, the whole thing has changed. See, now I'm an expert in porn again. We're going back to my things I never thought I knew.
It comes back to that.
I know. It always comes back to my expertise in porn. The things you learn in this business, you know, you never know what you can use them for.
It is true.
And what comes next? Is there a thing that you, is there an aspiration to do a certain thing going forward?
Absolutely. I feel really excited to just, I just want to tackle interesting roles. That's it. I just want to be challenged. I want to show more colors. You know, as actors, we're sometimes, we have so many colors inside of us, but sometimes we're asked to play the same ones. And I feel like Shameless gave me a new set of crayons, and I got to play around with that. And that opened up a lot of inspiration and excitement in me. So I want to pursue that, and I hope that I will have the time coming up to be able to do that. It was just a different color. Mm-hmm. So I really enjoyed that part of it.
Backstage?
Absolutely. I've been trying to do that every year, and it's very hard to time
it.
With a very small hiatus, it's hard to do, but I would love to go back to stage. That to me is everything, and that's the biggest connection of all to, I always say, you know, remember why you started to do it in the first place.
And you made a choice. I mean, it was really the choice to go to acting.
Yes,
but you made the right choice, it sounds like.
I made the right choice. I said that if I said I'm going to do this for this many years, and if it doesn't go and I'm not happy, I'll still be young enough to pursue something else. But 6 months after that, I had my first show, and sometimes I still feel like, well, you know, maybe this is the last one, and I'll go to do this or that, and then I find myself immersed in another story or a character that I feel compelled to do, and it's ultimately my first love.
So do you think you'd go back to producing, or do you think you'd go back something else?
Absolutely.
Completely out of show business?
Absolutely. I think that, in order to do television, I have to, knowing the commitment that one makes of so many years, I want to be sure to work with producers that I feel very close with, and I want to be part of that process on my next project.
And even producing if you're the producer.
Producing it and writing it. And so I'm working on that. I'm developing some things that would be my... hopefully a good vehicle for me.
Because you would think that would be like a whole different muscle group to go in and just produce, not to act primarily, but to actually invest in that way.
And I would do, and I would love to do that. I really would, because I love actors and I love the whole process of putting it together. So I find a lot of joy in it. I've had the opportunity to go behind the scenes on our show and learn a lot there and go on scouts with them and talk to the directors, and I think it's great. I mean, there's a lot of minutia and detail that isn't my favorite thing, but it is a different muscle.
And your parents ultimately approve, or your family ultimately approves of your...
you start making a living, and then you're doing well. Of course, any parent would approve. So yes, then you're like, listen, I don't need money from you. I'm gonna buy this. Then at that moment, it becomes real.
That's right.
But they still, my father's not around anymore, but my mother will see an interview if she was sitting here with us and watched me do it, and at the end she would go, God, I don't know how you do that. She's just so shy that she can't. It would never be in her to just be open and be able to just express herself in this way. And so she admires it, and she's always like a big fan of it, but she goes, I don't know how you do it.
It's hard for a lot of actors anyway, I think. I think, you know, it's not necessarily a job about exposing yourself. It's about hiding in somebody else's being. So a lot of actors are not so thrilled about doing it. But
and I'm not always, and it really depends on the person, and it depends on what you're talking about and what you're exchanging. But sometimes it's not the most fun, and sometimes it is.
Well, I'll have to think of some terrible questions to ask you next time.
Please don't.
Some way to make you miserable. Thank you so much for your time. Appreciate
it. Thank you. Thanks. So lovely. Thank you.